magician of iron, as Gustave Eiffel is known, is special for so many reasons. Although everyone knows his most famous work, the Eiffel Tower, Gustave had an influence in many other iconic structures. His lesser known, but just as important legacy of contributions to research and science play a role in many things we know about aerodynamics and meteorology today. So there's no better architect to kick off this new series of history's greatest architects than the magician of iron himself, Gustave Eiffel. Gustave Eiffel was born in 1832 in the town of Dijon, France. He was born to François-Alexandre Eiffel and Catherine Melanie Menu. Eiffel was not at first interested in his education, but due to the influence of his uncle Jean-Baptiste Mollerat, Eiffel began to take an interest in chemistry in his later years. Upon finishing school, he set out to further his education in Paris, where he studied at the College of Art and Manufacturing. At first, he focused on chemistry and learned a lot about metal construction, which led him to spend the first 20 years or so of his career focusing on engineering bridges.
Number 7.
The Passerelle Eiffel. A few years after university, Eiffel was hired as head of research at Pules & Company, where he received his first big project. Tasked with completing the construction of the 1,600-foot-long iron railway bridge, later named the Passerelle Eiffel, in the city of Bordeaux. The bridge had already been designed by Stanislas de la Roche-Tolle in 1858, and Eiffel was brought in as a young, then 26-year-old, construction manager to manage the project, and in particular, the foundations of the bridge. Eiffel proposed several changes to the foundations due to his research on hydraulic pressure and air compression. These changes were incorporated into the final design and helped to support the six pairs of masonry supporting the bridge securely.
Number 6.
Building the bridge at Bordeaux, it wasn't long before Eiffel decided to venture out on his own, and in 1866 he set out as a consulting engineer. He partnered with fellow engineer Théophile Seyrig to form the Eiffel at Sea, which translates to Eiffel & Company. Their first project together was the Rouzat Viaduct in 1867. This was to be another iron railway bridge located in Vichy, France. At first glance, the bridge doesn't look that impressive, but the area has significant horizontal wind loads, so the wrought iron towers had to be designed with a curved base as a way to counter the effects. This lateral stiffness allows the tower to manage the strong winds.
Number 5.
A decade later, Eiffel designed another one of his most famous works, the Maria Pia Bridge. Located over the Jura River in Portugal, it was a challenging project to win, as it had initially been announced as a competition by the Royal Portuguese Railway Company, and there were several more established competitors in the ring. Ultimately, price won out though, as Eiffel's estimations projected a budget two-thirds the cost of the others, so even though he was less established, he was able to win the proposal. Technically, it was a complicated job as well, due to the challenging nature of the river. It was known to flood, and the riverbed consisted of gravel, requiring the need for such a long central span. Construction took just under 2 years to complete, and used a relatively new engineering technique, with steel cables supporting two halves of the arch, as they were constructed and connected. When it was inaugurated by the King of Portugal in November 1878, the final deck length was over 1,100 feet long, with two pillars on the Via Nova Duguay side and two pillars on the Porto side.
Number 4.
The Nice Observatory. Finally taking a break from bridges, Eiffel tried his hand at constructing scientific buildings after finishing work on the Maria Pia Bridge. In 1878, he worked together with architect Charles Garnier to build the Nice Observatory at the top of Mount Gros in the southeast of France. Eiffel designed himself the movable dome of the observatory, which could accommodate a 30-inch refractor telescope made by Henri and Gautier. At the time, this meant the building had the largest telescope of any privately funded observatory, even though the Lick Observatory's 36-inch telescope in California was a more impressive design. Built at the height of 1,066 feet above sea level, the Nice Observatory was also higher than other top observatories at the time, such as those in Polkovo or Vienna.
Number 3.
During his career, Eiffel became more well known for using innovative engineering techniques. One of these was the use of compressed air caissons in bridge building. The word caisson simply means a large box, and what bridge engineers would do before Eiffel's time was to work in a box that was open to the air above. Eiffel preferred to use compressed air caissons which would be placed upon bedrock or hard mud and sealed at the top with compressed air to keep out water and mud. Although it sounds like it might be a lot of effort, ultimately it can speed up the construction process because placing concrete is better in dry conditions.
Number 2.
The Statue of Liberty reaches a total height of 300 feet in the New York City harbour. The iconic copper sculpture was completed under Frederic Auguste Bartholdi. However, the four gigantic steel supports which keep her looking over Manhattan over a century later were designed originally by Eugène Emmanuel Viollet-le-Duc, and then Eiffel took over when Viollet-le-Duc passed away in the middle of the project. Work began in 1875, but the status wasn't finally established in its new home until October of 1886. While keeping some of Viollet-le-Duc's plans for internal structure, such as the way the copper sheets were connected and plans for sculpting, Eiffel did change some critical elements of the supports. Instead of relying on weight to support the copper sheets, Eiffel aimed to create a skeletal iron truss structure that could be built in Paris and then deconstructed for its journey across the Atlantic to America. As the statue would be in New York, which gets extremely hot in the summer months, Eiffel had planned for the metal to expand. Therefore, he used flat iron bars to connect the support structure to the skin. To prevent iron and copper from corroding, he insulated the copper skin with asbestos. The end result is a structure that has stood the test of time and was beloved by New Yorkers from the moment it sailed into the harbour. The statue stands out more today than it did then, as its original dark brown copper colour has faded into its now famous green. Did you know? Built to commemorate the friendship of America and France, the Statue of Liberty was originally referred to as the Liberty Enlightening the World. She does this by holding both the Declaration of Independence in one hand and a 29-foot torch up in the other. Visitors can climb into her crown for breathtaking views of Manhattan. Of course, we can't talk about Gustave Eiffel without his most iconic work, the Eiffel Tower. Standing at an imposing 984 feet above Paris, with the tip reaching a total height of 1,063 feet, it has become Paris's most famous landmark. Almost 7 million people visit every single year and take the long stair climb or short elevator ride to the top. At the time of construction, and for the next 40 years afterward, it would be the tallest man-made structure in the world, and it's what gave Eiffel his nickname as the Magician of Iron. The project came about when the French government organised a competition to design a monument to celebrate the centenary of the French Revolution. They wanted this newly inaugurated building to coincide with the World's Fair they were planning for the event. Eiffel beat out 100 other designs with his wrought iron tower concept, and work on the tower began. The structure has four lattice girder piers that bend inwards to create one vertical tower. There are two horizontal piers so that tourists can visit the structure and look out over the Seine and the city of Paris. One of the purely aesthetic choices Eiffel made for the tower were four semi-arches between the tower bases, as the arches served no structural purpose. Also, the tower was originally painted a reddish-brown colour, but in the 1960s it changed to its current bronze colour. This paint has to be reapplied every 7 years, otherwise the structure would rust. Special elevators also had to be designed for the tower, as they needed to curve as they ascended. An American engineering company developed the glass cage elevators, which became one of the main features of the building. Parisians and tourists alike are lucky that the tower is still standing, as it was originally planned to be dismantled after 20 years, but as it was so useful for communication, the city decided to let it remain, Gustave Eiffel's influence can still be felt today, and not just in the cities of Paris and New York, but across the globe. His expertise in metal construction, in particular with his innovative iron bridges and buildings, elevated the understanding and appreciation of architecture. On the other hand, his scientific contributions and experiments he conducted in areas such as aerodynamics and meteorology are equally groundbreaking. For example, the donation of his aerodynamic laboratory to the state in 1921 meant that other researchers could build upon his work to develop more scientific breakthroughs. Eiffel truly had a far-reaching impact on many aspects of our lives today.
Enjoy this video. Tell us in the comments below what you found to be the most interesting and why. Also, if you haven't done so yet, make sure to hit the bell notification next to the subscribe button to stay up to date with all of our latest videos. Thank you for watching. I'll see you guys next time.